Hi everyone, and welcome back to another Sky Tonight Star Show from the Museum of Arts and Sciences. My name is Nicole, and today I have a very special episode for you all, starting with a trip to Jupiter, and then finally looking at some of the other summertime constellations. So first we're going to fly to our nearest gas giant planet. Now there are two different types of planets. We have the rocky and terrestrial planets, like we talked about in the last episode, which includes Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. We also have the gas giant planets, which are entirely composed of gas, mostly hydrogen and helium, like our own sun, but they're never big enough or hot enough to become stars, so instead they are planets. Now we'll go to the first gas giant planet, the one closest to Earth, and that would be the largest planet in our solar system, which is Jupiter. Now, as we approach Jupiter, you'll see the red orbit lines of its moons. So it has over 79 confirmed moons, which is the second most in the entire solar system, only after Saturn, which we will talk about next week. So here we are at Jupiter. Of course, the largest planet in our solar system, over 318 times the mass of Earth itself. And there's a lot of distinctive features about this gas giant planet, which I'll talk about right now. So like I said, it's made up of mostly hydrogen and helium, like our own sun. It has distinct cloud features made up of ammonia and sulfur. And you see this area right here? That is something called the Great Red Spot. It's essentially a giant dust storm that has been going on for over 350 years. And that area itself is about three times the size of Earth. Jupiter also has the shortest day of all of the planets, so it takes 10 hours to spin once on its axis. Compared to Earth, it takes 24 hours. And I bring up Jupiter because it will be in a very special position this week. So Jupiter reaches opposition on July 14th, which is the best time to see and photograph the planet since it appears the largest and brightest in the sky. Now this happens when Earth finds itself directly between the Sun and another planet. So from our point of view on Earth, Jupiter is on the opposite side of the sky to the Sun. Now this occurs roughly about every 13 months for Jupiter, and that's depending on how long it takes the Earth to travel once around the Sun relative to the planet. So it means this occurs almost every single year, as Earth is on its much faster orbit. It's also smaller as well. So this year it's July 14th, but next year it will be mid-August. Definitely take a look at the sky. It will be close to Saturn in the evening, like I talked about in the last video, but at the end of this one, I'll remind you on how you can find this planet, especially since it's the best time for viewing. So now I am back using the Solarium program as we talk about some of the other summertime constellations and how you can find them on your own. So we'll start just by orienting ourselves using the cardinal directions and some other known constellations. So you'll see we're facing west here, and this is around 11 o'clock at night. Now you'll be able to see these constellations before and after that time, but it just will be in a different position in the sky. I think an easier way to start finding the constellations today is to use a popular asterism, which I talked about in my last videos. Now you might be able to pick it out easily already since it is the most famous asterism that I can think of, and that would be the Big Dipper. So we've got the shape right here. Now that's part of the much larger constellation called Ursa Major, and I'll put up the shape of the Greater Bear here. Now we're going to use this constellation to find some other ones. Using the handle of the Big Dipper here, if you follow the arc to Arcturus, you will land on this star in the constellation Boötes. So just remember that little phrase, follow the arc to Arcturus. And here we have the constellation. Now written out, it looks like the word boots, but it's actually pronounced Boötes. And that is the first constellation that I want to talk about today. So it is one of the larger constellations in the nighttime sky. It has five stars with known planets, and it's supposed to be a herdsman with two hunting dogs on a leash and a club in his hand. So it is also called the Bear Guard constellation, Because it is close to Ursa Major, of course, the Greater Bear. Now you can also see it's called a kite because of this almost diamond shape right here. So that's another easy way to put the constellation together. It also contains something called the Boötes Void, or the Great Nothing, which is a space about 330 million light years in diameter. It's a spherical region with very few galaxies. And it's one of the largest known voids in the universe, which makes it a super void. I also want to mention the brightest star in the constellation, which is, of course, Arcturus. It is the third brightest star in the sky, and actually the brightest star of any north of the celestial equator. So, of all the stars in the northern hemisphere, Arcturus is the brightest. Only 37 light years away from us, so relatively close compared to some of the other stars that we've talked about before. And it's an orange giant star, so you'll be able to see that orangish red color in the sky, and that'll help you easily identify it again using this arc from the Big Dipper. I can see here that Arcturus is a double star, meaning that there's actually two, but you can only see one because of how far away it is. And it appears to be traveling with a group of 52 other old disk stars, and that's called the Arcturus Stream. Arcturus is actually approaching the end of its lifetime. So it's a red giant star that has stopped fusing hydrogen, and now it's fusing carbon. In the life cycle of a star, it'll burn through all these elements, and then once it gets to the final elements, it has nothing left to burn. That will be the end of the star's lifetime. So once it uses up all of the helium that is left, it will turn into a white dwarf star and might be a variable star in the last stages of its life. Now, our own sun might follow a path similar to this one. So I think it's very interesting to track how these stars evolve and decay over time. Now, the name Arcturus means guardian of the bear in ancient Greek, and that's again very fitting because of how close it is to Ursa Major. So now we've got one constellation down, and I'll show you another easy way to identify the next one. And that's again using the handle of the Big Dipper. So we're going to follow the arc to Arcturus and spike on down to Spica. And that would be the star of our next constellation, which is Virgo the Maiden. Now, Virgo is one of the zodiac constellations, and it was first cataloged by the Greek astronomer Ptolemy in the 2nd century. It's the second largest constellation in the nighttime sky, even bigger than Ursa Major itself. So, when I say it's one of the zodiac constellations, that means it lies along a path called the ecliptic, which is the apparent path of the sun across the sky. So we talked about that last time, that the sun appears to follow this arc around the Earth. And there are all the zodiac constellations which lie along it. And Virgo is just one of the 13. The sun will be in the constellation Virgo on the date of the September equinox. So that'll be later this year. And it's only one of two points in the sky where the celestial equator intersects with the ecliptic. So you can see here the celestial equator is the projection of Earth's equator into the sky, and it intercepts right here with the sun's path near the constellation Virgo. Now, Virgo has lots of deep sky objects located within this constellation, many bright galaxies, some of which you can see with a telescope. It has over 20 stars with known planets, and that is more than any other constellation out there. I also want to talk more about Spica, the brightest star in the constellation Virgo. Now, it's the 15th brightest star in the sky and blue-white in color. So I mentioned the color because that has to do with a star's temperature. So the blue-white stars are the hottest of all. Getting cooler, we have white stars, yellow stars like our own sun. After that would be orange, and finally the reddish orange are going to be the coolest of all. So it's a little backwards, but I think of it like fire. So the hottest part of the fire is the blue-white part, and the same goes for stars. And you can see here that Spica is a variable star and a double star, again meaning that there are two, But we can only see the one because of how far away it is. It's about 260 light years away from Earth. So a little bit further than Arcturus, but still takes over 260 years for the light to reach us. Now, Spica is one of the nearest massive double stars to our own solar system. And it's one of the nearest ones that is sufficiently evolved and massive enough to explode as a supernova. So earlier when we talked about the end of a life cycle of a star, sometimes they swell and expand once they've finished fusing all their elements, but other times if there's enough energy and fuel, it will instead explode into something called a supernova. So once Spica approaches the end of its lifetime, it could explode in a supernova, and it would be very beautiful in our nighttime sky. It would just take hundreds of years for us to know about it because of how long it takes this light to reach us. Now in mythology, Spica means Virgo's ear of grain, and you can see here with the depiction. So those are just some facts about the stars and constellations, so you know a little bit more about what you're looking at when you search for them in the sky. Just remember you can use the Big Dipper, since that's pretty easy to find. Follow the arc to Arcturus and speed on down to Spica. That's a very easy way to find that group of stars. Now there's one more asterism I want to point out. So a couple of shows ago I talked about the summer triangle, made up of three bright stars in separate constellations. But during this time of the year, you can also see another popular asterism called the spring triangle. And that is made up of the stars that we just talked about, including Arcturus, Spica, and another star down here called Denebola. And that is in the constellation Leo the Lion, which I talked about last week. Now, some astronomers say that the spring triangle actually includes Regulus, but as you can see, Regulus sets pretty early in the evening, so it's a little harder to witness during this time of the year. It's below the horizon already. So for the sake of our stargazing tonight, you can just think of the spring triangle as these three stars here. And there's another popular asterism that you can take a look for when you are gazing at the stars tonight. And I'll finish up the show with a reminder on how you can see Jupiter, since again, it's at opposition on July 14th, one of the best times to see it. We're going to be looking in the southeastern sky, and you'll definitely be able to see these two brighter planets, since they stand out amongst even the brightest of stars. So keep an eye out for Jupiter, and let me know if you're able to see this planet during the time of opposition. I hope this helped you learn more about some constellations and easy ways for finding them. Just remember the little phrases that I mentioned earlier, and you'll be picking out these constellations in no time. Happy stargazing!